This sentence, next sentence really bothers me. The official services of America, national, state, and municipal, in all their branches and departments, except the judiciary, are saturated in corruption, bribery, falsehood, maladministration, and the judiciary is tainted.
Good afternoon. I am honored to be here. I suppose I was invited in my capacity as an elected official, but I really stand here as a sister in solidarity to this movement of resistance and self-determination. We are all artists in some way, civic artisans, and now more than ever, as someone who studies trauma, I am sure that we are in the midst of it. And it isn't PTSD because there's nothing post about it. But while we're in the midst of that trauma, it is critical that we create spaces of healing and community. And as a woman, as a Black woman, who is a survivor of sexual violence, I can say I certainly need to be in spaces that are committed to that healing. Before I get to my formal text, I'll share with you, as a woman of faith, I create a space for prayer, reflection, and meditation every day. And there's a book that I use every day to guide me in that by Joshua Dubois called The President's Devotionals. And one of the readings, days after the election outcome, was entitled A Gentle Battle. And I'll paraphrase it. Ostensibly, it says that each morning we awaken to a gentle battle. And we have to decide, how will our minds be focused? Will our minds go in the direction of worry, weariness, and indifference, or in the direction of peace, love, and joy? Of all the negotiations and decisions of our day, this one is the most important. How will our minds be focused? As soldiers, in what direction will we march? I want to thank each and every one of you in that gentle battle this morning for choosing to march in the direction of peace, of love, of joy, and equality. Thank you. Now, I'm sure it will come as no surprise for those who know me and the many literary influences in my life. I will be reading from Maya Angelou. And I'll be reading an excerpt from her inaugural poem, On the Pulse of Morning. Come, clad in peace, and I will sing the songs the Creator gave to me when I and the tree and the rock were one. Before cynicism was a bloody sear across your brow, and when you yet knew, you still knew nothing. The river sang and sings on. There's a true yearning to respond to the singing river and the wise rock. So say the Asian, the Hispanic, the Jew, the African, the Native American, the Sioux, the Catholic, the Muslim, the French, the Greek, the Irish, the rabbi, the priest, the sheik, the gay, the straight, the preacher, the privileged, the homeless, the teacher. They hear, they all hear the speaking of the tree. They hear the first and last of every tree speak to humankind today. Come to me, here beside the river, plant yourself beside the river, each of you. Descendants of some past on traveler has been paid for. You who gave me my first name, you, Pawnee, Apache, Seneca, you, Cherokee Nation who rested with me, then forced on bloody feet left me to the employment of other seekers, desperate for gain, starving for gold. You, the Turk, the Arab, the Swede, the German, the Eskimo, the Scots, the Italian, the Hungarian, the Pole, you, the Ashanti, the Yoruba, the crew, brought, sold, stolen, arriving on a nightmare, praying for a dream. Here, root yourselves beside me. I am that tree planted by the river, which will not be moved. I, the rock, I, the river, I, the tree, I am yours. Your passages have been paid. Lift up your faces, you have a piercing need for this bright morning dawning for you. History, despite its wrenching pain, cannot be unlived, but if faced with courage, need not be lived again. Lift up your eyes upon this day breaking for you. Give birth again to the dream. Women, children, men, take it into the palms of your hands, mold it into the shape of your most private need, sculpt it into the image of your most public self. Lift up your hearts. Each new hour holds new chances for a new beginning. Do not be wedded forever to fear, yoked eternally to brutishness. The horizon leans forward, offering you space to place new steps of change here on the pulse of this fine day. You may have the courage to look up and out and upon me, the rock, the river, the tree, your country. No less to Midas than the mendicant, no less to you now than the mastodon then. Here on the pulse of this new day, you may have the grace to look up and out and into your sister's eyes and into your brother's face, your country, and say simply, very simply, with hope, good morning.
Donald Trump famously announced his candidacy by slandering Mexican immigrants. Quote, they're bringing drugs, they're bringing crime, they're rapists. The perception of immigrants as dangerous is dangerous. 1 month later, two South Boston brothers, Scott and Steve Leader, came across a homeless Mexican immigrant, Guillermo Rodriguez, at the JFK T-stop on their way back from a Red Sox game, woke him up by urinating in his face, then beat him with a pole, breaking his nose. Scott Leader said to the police, Donald Trump is right, all these illegals need to be deported. Trump, upon hearing the news, responded that his supporters were passionate. I want to read two poems of my own in response to Trump's demonization, dehumanization, and scapegoating of immigrants. I worked for many years as a lawyer representing Latino and Latina immigrants in Greater Boston. I saw and heard many strange things in court. This first poem is a found poem, and it's a bilingual poem, four lines. The only thing you need to know to understand this poem is that there is a mistranslation in the middle, which makes perfect sense since for Latinos, the legal system is mostly a series of mistranslations anyway. Mariano explains Yankee colonialism to Judge Collings. Judge, does the prisoner understand his rights? Interpreter, ¿entiendes esos derechos? Prisoner, pa'l carajo. Interpreter, yes. That's it. And by the way, this poem appears in a book of mine that was banned in Arizona. The second poem is a 9/11 poem, but it's a 9/11 poem with a twist. The focus here is on the food service workers killed at the World Trade Center, mostly immigrant and many of them undocumented, invisible in life, even more invisible in death. And the meaning of this poem has changed in this, the age of Trump. The word alabanza means praise in Spanish. And the full title of this poem is Alabanza in Praise of Local 100. For the 43 members of hotel employees and restaurant employees, Local 100, working at the Windows on the World restaurant, who lost their lives in the attack on the World Trade Center. Alabanza. Praise the cook with a shaven head and a tattoo on his shoulder that said, Oye. A blue-eyed Puerto Rican with people from Fajardo, the harbor of pirates centuries ago. Praise the lighthouse in Fajardo, candle glittering white to worship the dark saint of the sea. Alabanza. Praise the cook's yellow pirate's cap worn in the name of Roberto Clemente, his plane that flamed into the ocean loaded with cans for Nicaragua, for all the mouths chewing the ash of earthquakes. Alabanza. Praise the kitchen radio dial click even before the dial on the oven so that music and Spanish rose before bread. Praise the bread. Alabanza. Praise Manhattan from 107 flights up, like Atlantis glimpsed through the windows of an ancient aquarium. Praise the great windows where immigrants from the kitchen could squint and almost see their world. Hear the chant of nations. Ecuador, Mexico, República Dominicana, Haiti, Yemen, Ghana, Bangladesh, Alabanza. Praise the kitchen in the morning where the gas burned blue on every stove and exhaust fans fired their diminutive propellers, hands cracked eggs with quick thumbs or sliced open cartons to build an altar of cans. Alabanza. Praise the busboy's music, the chime of his dishes and silverware in the tub. Alabanza. Praise the dish dog, the dishwasher who worked that morning because another dishwasher could not stop coughing or because he needed overtime to pile the sacks of rice and beans for a family floating away on some Caribbean island plagued by frogs. Alabanza. Praise the waitress who heard the radio in the kitchen and sang to herself about a man gone. Alabanza. After the thunder, wilder than thunder, after the shudder deep in the glass of the great windows, after the radio stops singing like a tree full of terrified frogs, after night burst the dam of day and flooded the kitchen, for a time the stoves glowed in darkness like the lighthouse in Fajardo, like a cook's soul. Soul, I say, even if the dead cannot tell us about the bristles of God's beard because God has no face. Soul, I say, to name the smoke beings flung in constellations across the night sky of this city and cities to come. Alabanza, I say, even if God has no face. Alabanza. When the war began, from Manhattan and Kabul, two constellations of smoke rose and drifted to each other, mingling in icy air, and one said with an Afghan tongue, teach me to dance. We have no music here. And the other said with a Spanish tongue, I will teach you. Music is all we have. Muchas gracias. Thank you very much.
It's so good to be here with all of you today. I'm here for many reasons, but most urgently in support of Planned Parenthood. It's an organization I believe in passionately, and one that has directly benefited me and many of the women in this room. For nearly a century, Planned Parenthood has been a voice for women's health and reproductive freedom in the face of concerted and sometimes vicious opposition. That has never been truer than it is today. Planned Parenthood is under attack. And make no mistake, an attack on this organization is an attack on all women. If you've ever been to the Planned Parenthood on Comm Ave as a patient or as a friend or partner of a patient or, like me, as a volunteer, you know that this is a remarkable place. Women of all backgrounds are welcomed and treated with respect. If you take a look around the waiting room, you begin to understand the incredible reach of this organization. You'll see women dressed in uniform, straight from jobs in retail or food service, sitting next to poor students and students with trust funds and soccer moms from Newton. No one is turned away. If you're indigent or homeless or addicted, you can expect the same excellent care. Of course, all this costs money. About 75% of Planned Parenthood's budget comes from Medicaid reimbursements. For low-income patients, for contraception or STD screening or cancer screening. Now, if this administration has its way, all that money is about to disappear. And for some of these patients, the nurses and doctors at Planned Parenthood are the only providers they ever see. So, if Medicaid stops covering your appointments, where do you go for contraception, STD testing, cancer screening? The answer is, you don't. The soccer mom from Newton can simply find another gynecologist, but for poor women, the consequences will be deadly. So, if you believe in a woman's right to choose, and by this I mean a woman's ability to make complex moral decisions without government intervention, support Planned Parenthood. If you care about keeping women healthy and alive, support Planned Parenthood. Now I'm going to read a poem by Kim Adonizio. It's an angry poem. It's called Dead Girls. Because I truly believe that women's health and even women's lives are at stake. Dead girls show up often in the movies, face down in the weeds beside the highway. Kids find them by the river or in the woods under leaves, one pink-nailed hand thrust up. Detectives stand over them in studio apartments or lift their photos off pianos in the houses they almost grew up in. A dead girl can kick a movie into gear better than a saloon brawl, better than a factory explosion, just by lying there. Anyone can play her. Any child off the street can be hogtied and dumped from a van or strangled blue in a kitchen, a bathroom, an alley, a school. That's the beauty of a dead girl. Even a plain one who feels worthless as a clod of dirt, broken by the sorrow of gazing all day at a fashion magazine, can be made whole, redeemed, by what she finally can't help being, the center of attention, the special, desirable, dead, dead girl.
My name is Giles Lee. I'm the executive director of a multi-service organization in Chinatown. We serve low-income and immigrant population. Over the past 2 months, the young people at my organization have been asking their classroom teachers if their parents are going to be deported, what they should expect. And if I were not a writer and a reader of poetry, I don't know where I would find the strength to be able to go into work every day. It's no coincidence I actually keep a copy of Imagine the Angels of Bread in my desk drawer, so it's really an honor to be here with everybody who's reading and Martinez Spada in particular. He's been an inspiration to me and to all of us, I'm sure. The poem, Self-Help for Fellow Refugees by Lee Young Lee. If your name suggests a country where bells might have been used for entertainment or to announce the entrances and exits of the seasons and the birthdays of gods and demons, it's probably best to dress in plain clothes when you arrive in the United States and try not to talk too loud. If you happen to have watched armed men beat and drag your father out the front door of your house and into the back of an idling truck before your mother jerked you from the threshold and buried your face in her skirt folds, try not to judge your mother too harshly. Don't ask her what she thought she was doing, turning a child's eyes away from history and toward that place all human aching starts. And if one day you meet someone in your adopted country and believe you see in the other's face an open sky, some promise of a new beginning, it probably means you're standing too far away. Or if you think you read in the other, as in a book, whose first and last pages are missing, the story of your own birthplace, a country twice erased, once by fire, once by forgetfulness, it probably means you're standing too close. In any case, try not to let another carry the burden of your own nostalgia or hope. And if you're one of those whose left side of the face doesn't match the right, it might be a clue looking the other way was a habit your predecessors found useful for survival. Don't lament not being beautiful. Get used to seeing while not seeing. Get busy remembering while forgetting, dying to live while not wanting to go on. Very likely, your ancestors decorated their bells of every shape and size with elaborate calendars and diagrams of distant star systems, but no maps for scattered descendants. And I bet you can't say what language your father spoke when he shouted to your mother from the back of the truck, "Let the boy see." Maybe it wasn't the language you used at home. Maybe it was a forbidden language. Or maybe there was too much screaming and weeping and the noise of guns in the streets. It doesn't matter. What matters is this: the kingdom of heaven is good, but heaven on earth is better. Thinking is good, but living is better. Alone in your favorite chair with a book you enjoy is fine, but spooning is even better. Thank you.
50 years ago, the object of a great deal of resistance was the Vietnam War. At the time, many of us who were protesting that war did not know much about Vietnamese writers, and many of us in the years since have come to know them. What I would like to read today are two poems by Vietnamese writers written during the 1970s and 1980s by writers who are not necessarily known at the time or weren't as resistance writers, but I think both of these poems speak to where we are today. The first is by Nguyen Quang Thieu, a poem called The Black Ants. Sleepy car wheels carried away the laughter, cries, and death of alcohol. They carried away men's fingers crawling up women's legs. Now nothing is left on the banquet table but bowls, plates, cups, and empty bottles, and the whirlwind of a ceiling fan singing about the sadness of things. Black ants crossed the banquet table as if it were a battlefield filled with bits of meat and dead bodies of basil. The ants embrace red pepper as if it were a tattered flag. It makes their eyes water. They creep over bones. They creep over skin under the wail of the fan. The false sun of a 1,000-watt bulb sets at the flick of a black switch. The whirlwind fan turns more and more slowly until it dies, spreading its three black wings. Now all that's left are the black ants with watering eyes, helping each other back toward their burrows, dark and deep. And the second poem is by Lamti Misa, a rather unusual poem at the time. This was written in the 1970s, 80s, when women did not usually speak in the kind of voice that Lamti Misa is speaking in here. Small as a doll. How can you be deep enough to reflect me? How can you be wide enough to shade my life? How can you be tall enough to see all of me? A sweet life, a woman steps forward. A weary life, a woman steps back. Hey, me, how can you be a woman when a woman has to be small, small as a doll, to find happiness? However small we may feel as individuals, may we all come out of our burrows and be large together. Kamnin kakain kakchi. Thank you all very much.
Hello, I'm Dale Peterson from Penn, New England. Thank you all for coming. I've been asked to stand in for my dear, dear friend, Henry Thoreau, who unfortunately isn't able to make it here in person. He's getting along in years, as most of you know, and he doesn't quite feel like his old self today. But he wants to assure everyone here that under better circumstances, he would have been the first to participate in the Boston iteration of Writers Resist. Under better circumstances, Henry would have been delighted to walk all the way down from Concord in order to be here. But he sends his greetings, and he has asked me to read this brief note. Like the rest of us, Henry has a lot on his mind right now. Many things trouble him as we move into a new era with a new administration looming ahead. Henry wants you to know that he is particularly alarmed by the incoming president's reckless denial of science and climate change. Oh, my friend Henry, he says in this note, recognize the comic parts of our current political drama, the ridiculous strutting and posturing, the silly hats and the angry pouts, the hair, the thin skin, the little hands, the small mind, the short fuse, the ridiculous acts of spite and illiterate messages sent out like the frantic tweeting of distracted birds in the hour before dawn. This ongoing burlesque, this now predictable regurgitation of crude comedy, is the defining behavior, Henry thinks, of a coarse and boisterous money-making fellow, and it must not distract us from the genuine threats being brought to bear by that scowling bully, and yes, Henry wants to say this too, by the political cabal that has been his bully enabler. These are threats to our country, our community, and our democracy. Of course, Henry is no hermit. He is socially aware, socially committed. He voted, and we all know exactly who he voted for. No question about that. Nevertheless, he also wants to remind us that all voting is a sort of gaming, like checkers or backgammon, with a slight moral tinge to it, a playing with right and wrong. Henry cast his own vote as he thought to be morally right, but he did not consider himself to be, as he says, vitally concerned that his vote should prevail. He was willing to leave that to the majority. And even when, as in this case, the voting process itself was manipulated by a hostile foreign power and a domestic agency, the KGB, the FBI, so that the majority will was in fact thwarted, Henry still believes that a wise man will neither leave the matter of moral right to the mercy of chance or to the power of the majority. How can a man or woman be satisfied to entertain a moral opinion merely and enjoy that? Henry asks rhetorically. Is there any enjoyment in it if the opinion is that he or she is aggrieved? And yes, Henry himself is truly aggrieved by this election. Yes, he feels cheated. If you are cheated out of a single dollar by your neighbor, he says in this note, you do not rest satisfied with knowing you are cheated or with saying that you are cheated or even with petitioning your neighbor to pay your due, but you take effectual steps at once to obtain the full amount and you see that you are never cheated again. Action from principle, the perception and the performance of right changes things and relations. Action from principle is essentially revolutionary. It not only divides states and churches, it divides families. It divides the individual, separating the diabolic from the divine. In other words, Henry exhorts us all here, we as people and thinkers and writers who act through principle, we must cast our whole vote, not a strip of paper merely, but our whole influence. My friend Henry wants us to all know today that he too recognizes the injustices that this new government is leaning towards, unraveling the safety net for the disadvantaged, promoting increased wealth for the already fabulously wealthy, working to divide Americans along the lines of class and race and creed. This is the outrage, Henry thinks, the un-American injustice. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere, he says in his note. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. If injustice is of such a nature that it requires you to be the agent of injustice to another, he continues, then I say, break the law. Let your life be a counter-friction to stop the machine. Under a government that imprisons anyone unjustly, the true place for a man or woman is also a prison. Finally, Henry wants me to remind everyone here today that we must not withdraw into cynicism or be paralyzed by despair. Read the Globe and read the Times, yes, but also read the Eternities. Go outdoors, look up at the stars, live in each season as it passes. Breathe the air, drink the drink, taste the fruit, and resign yourself to the influence of the earth. Henry knows that he's old now, but his mind is still very young, and his door is still open to anyone who wants to visit. Just look him up. He'll be there. Thank you.
Some of us, through unearned advantage, have room to celebrate the idea of American democracy. Frederick Douglass would remind us that others, restrained by its empty promises, see the sounds of rejoicing as empty and heartless, our denunciation of tyrants as brass-fronted impudence, our shouts of liberty and equality as hollow mockery. In the spirit of that unfair confinement, we offer this poem in honor of Herman Wallace, whose incarceration provides a bracing metaphor for Americans still waiting for their nation to rise up and live the meaning of its creed. Herman Wallace spent 41 years in solitary confinement in Louisiana State Penitentiary in Angola, Louisiana, until in 2013, a judge found his original indictment to be unconstitutional. For 41 years, he spent up to 23 hours a day in a cell that was 6 feet by 9 feet. This is 6 by 9 for Herman Wallace. They come shuffling opposite the clock in the middle of the night, calling on me, a man in a box. The dull orange eye overhead never sees them, never blinks at the light they bring, or their purposeful hum, rattling the bars and rising above the relentless screams. After 41 years, I know their faces, ring shouters, regular as hash marks on a wall. Their circle of rhythm glows bright as the memory of stars, dark matter and miracles in a Dixie dungeon, 6 feet long, 9 feet wide. They come clapping like saints, drunk on glory, stamping their bare heels, tapping strange celestial sticks. At their center, a woman sings, her voice sun-dappled and sweet. My eyes meet hers, and I know what God once looked like. Oh Lord, the circle shouts. I open my mouth to the sound, and through the wall I see constellations whirling against the infinite blackness. Chariots, dark angels, and runaways, meaning to be free.
Oh, Lordy, trouble so hard. Yes, indeed, my trouble so hard.
The circle of souls hollers and hums, palms kiss and stretch toward the sky. Outside my cell, the guards doze under a spell. Inside, a woman steps forward and the ring makes room.
This was the way of it, brethren. I spent 7 years in a crawl space in North Carolina, fleeing from rape and ruin, emancipation on my mind. 7 years cold, cramped, and confined. 7 years praying and hiding and planning. 7 years whispering and waiting and suffering the nearby cries of my children until I could be called anything but owned. That was my world. 9 feet long, 7 feet wide, 3 feet high.
She turns to me.
You see, I know what it's like to bleed in a box.
The circle of souls hollers and hums, palms kiss and stretch toward the sky.
Oh, Lordy, trouble so hard. Don't nobody know my trouble but God.
A man takes the middle, and the ring makes room. This was the way of it, brethren. Sick of Virginia sickness, I folded my chances in a wooden crate and shipped myself to Philadelphia freedom. 27 hours on rutted roads and rails, 27 hours end over end and scraped by nails, 27 hours enduring and thirsting and stinking until I was delivered into friendly hands. That was my world, 3 feet long, 2 feet 8 inches wide, 2 feet deep. I know what it's like to dream in a box. The circle claps hands and hallelujahs. Every voice lifts and sings.
Went down the hill the other day, so got happy and stayed all day. Oh, Lordy, trouble so hard. Oh, Lordy, trouble so hard.
Amid the music, an elder appears, sturdy despite his years. This was the way of it, brethren. Home from war and still wearing my stripes, I took a sip from a whites-only fountain in the heart of Georgia. The mob stomped me blind, and I woke up in a morgue drawer, pronounced dead before my time. Eternity trapped in a freezing tomb, eternity kicking and pounding in the airless gloom until I was discovered black and breathing. That was my world, 6 feet 4 inches long, 2 feet high. I know what it's like to struggle in a box. Dawn comes, the ring shouters shuffle, and Angola rushes in. Crude jokes and curses, promises and pleading, screams regular as hash marks on a wall. One bright hour, the shouters will take my hand and welcome me into their midnight band. Until then, I'm left alone with time clotting my blood and vexing my bones, eating at me from inside. This is my world, locked and solitary since 1972. 41 years drying on the line, 41 years rotting on the vine, 41 years of 6 by 9. This is the way of it, brethren. I'm a man. 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 I'm a man in a box.
Oh, Lordy, you trouble so hard. Oh, Lordy, trouble so. Jim Crow, the sequel by June Jordan. An angry black woman on the subject of the angry white man. We didn't always need affirmative action. When we broke this crazy land into farms, when we planted and harvested the crops, when we dug into the earth for water, when we carried that water into the big house, kitchens and bedrooms, when we built that big house, when we fed and clothed other people's children with food we cooked and served to other people's children, wearing the garments that we fitted and we sewed together, when we hacked and hauled huge trees for lumber and fuel, when we washed and polished the chandeliers, when we bleached and pressed the linens purchased by blood profits from our daily forced laborings, when we lived under the whip and in between the cuffle and chains, when we watched our babies sold away from us, when we lost our men to anybody's highest bidder, when slavery defined our days and our prayers and our night times of no rest, then we did not need affirmative action. Like two-legged livestock, we cost the boss man $315 or $675. So he provided our keep. Like two-legged livestock, penned into the parched periphery of very grand plantation life, we did not need affirmative action. No, we needed freedom. We needed overthrow, revolution, and a holy fire to purify the air. But for 200 years, this crazy land, the law, and the bullets behind the law continued to affirm the gospel of God-given white supremacy. For 200 years, the law and the bullets behind the law and the money and the politics behind the bullets behind the law affirmed the gospel of God-given white supremacy, God-given male white supremacy, and neither the Emancipation Proclamation, nor the Civil War, nor one constitutional amendment after another could bring about a yielding of the followers of that gospel to the beauty of our human face. Justice don't mean nothing to hateful hearts. And so we needed affirmative action. We needed a way into the big house besides the back door. We needed a chance at the classroom and jobs and open housing in okay neighborhoods. We needed a way around the hateful hearts of America. We needed more than the freedom, because a piece of paper ain't the same as an opportunity or education. And some 30 years ago, we agitated, and we agitated, until the president said, "We seek not just equality as a right and a theory, but equality as a fact and as a result." And a great rejoicing rose, like a spirit dancing, fresh and happy, on the soon-to-be integrated and most uppity ballroom floor of these United States. And black folks everywhere dressed up in African-American pride and optimism. From the littlest to the elders, we shined our shoes and brushed our hair and got good and ready for equality as a fact. But 3 decades later, and come to find out, we never got invited to the party. We never got included in the people. We never got no kind of affirmative action worth more than a spit in the wind. And yesterday, the new man in the White House, the new president, declared, "What we have done for women and minorities is a good thing, but we must respond to those who feel discriminated against. This is a psychologically difficult time for the so-called angry white man." Well, I am here to tell you that 46% of my children living in poverty does not make me feel good. And my brothers in prison and not in college does not feel good to me, psychologically or otherwise. Catch that angry white man and tell him, get a grip. 46% of the American labor force is constituted by white men, but white men occupy 95% of all senior management positions. And as a wise black man recently observed, this supposedly beleaguered minority, white males are about 1/3 of the population, makes up 80% of the Congress, 4/5 of tenured university faculty, 9/10 of the Senate, and 92% of the Forbes 400. Tell me who's angry. I say, the problem with affirmative action seems to me like way too much affirmative talk and too little action.
In 1968, with more than 500,000 U.S. troops in Vietnam stymied by the communist enemy, escalation pressures inside the Pentagon were building toward the use of nuclear weapons, the risk of global war. On May 17th, 1968, Daniel Berrigan and 8 others removed selective service files from the draft board offices in Catonsville, Maryland. In the parking lot, they set the papers aflame using homemade napalm. The action spurred the broader anti-war movement, which stopped the U.S. escalation toward nuclear use cold, even if the war dragged on. Berrigan and the others showed that resistance to the criminal behavior of government can succeed. Daniel Berrigan, a Jesuit priest, was an admired poet, an exemplar of the writer resisting. In court, the trial of the Catonsville Nine began with Daniel Berrigan reciting this poem. "Our apologies, good friends, for the fracture of good order, the burning of paper instead of children, the angering of the orderlies in the front parlor of the charnel house. We could not, so help us God, do otherwise, for we are sick at heart. Our hearts give us no rest for thinking of the land of the burning children. We say killing is disorder. Life and gentleness and community and unselfishness is the only order we recognize. How long must the world's resources be raped in the service of legalized murder? When, at what point, will you say no to this war? We have chosen to say, with the gift of our liberty, if necessary, our lives, the violence stops here. The death stops here. The suppression of truth stops here. This war stops here. Good friends, Trump stops here.
Hello, I'm Kofi Dodzi. I'm 18 years old, and I'm a part of Mass Leap along with Michelle. We're a youth organization that focuses around spoken word poetry and social justice. And the first poem I'm going to do for you is Police Brutality from the Point of View of a Baton. I orchestrate brutality, but I never wanted to compose this symphony. We batons fell into the role masterfully, though, as the blue Beethovens adorned in badges used us to keep the beat on black notes. It's just that the syncopation of their screams is always the hardest to hear. As it ends and repeats, voices crescendo in agony as we direct the masterpiece. We helped create a piece once. We titled him Rodney. Reduced his life to 8 minutes of mutilation, but that song got old real quick. So we found new symphony halls wherever the bars kept black notes in place. See, it's hard to be a conductor for this symphony, especially when they twirl you like color guard on parade, eager and willing to control the next tune. See, we batons, the color of midnight, turn black bodies into battered heaps. Now, ain't that black on black crime? Are we just an officer's token black friend? Would he put us down the minute we look threatening too? See, we do our best to quell the rhythm of rebellion. We put rests on the voices of colored women so we can play the same tired tune over and over again. They never seem to get a solo. Only seen as a supplement to a black man's medley, the audience doesn't seem to like this piece anymore. America don't seem to like peace anymore. See, black folk never wanted to be in admittance hell. We never even bought tickets, but we've been instrumental in his creation. Unplugged from society, all we wanted to do was make music. We never expected the dissonance of black instruments to create the best melody, yet keeping time on torture was something of a classical arrangement for us. Like leaving bodies to hang in the breeze like high notes. Like massacre is musical. So not for nothing, we have masterminded the murder of a people, have turned maiming into an artificial art form. We couldn't have done it on our own because he who holds my handle wishes I were a whip, misses the sound of its crack and decided to make music instead. But who am I to judge when I am cut from the same wood that decorates that whip's handle? We are tired of making songs out of suffering, of turning the altercations between my maestro and black folk into twisted duets. Remove me from my master's hand before the body count rises like chord progression. We pray this piece sees a finale soon, but for now, the show must go on. America always wants an encore. And then, Muhammad Ali writes a letter to Kanye West on greatness. So you really think you the greatest? You really think you the champ? Cause me, I'm bad, man. Bad. See, I done rumbled in the jungle, taking titles in the East. I've gone toe-to-toe with giants. I've sang lullabies to sleep. Well, only last week, I murdered a rock, injured a stone, hospitalized a brick, man. I'm so mean, I make medicine sick. And the only thing that sickens me is that a country can go to war when it's at war with itself, can dehumanize its citizens, can question their pride, can prevent black boys from being anything other than animal, than creature, Like the most talented people in the world can't be black, like only talent is to lit up their cities and fill up their jail cells. They tried to strip me of my title, Kanye. Like I wasn't the greatest for saying what I thought. See, they don't expect blacks to think. Don't expect us to say anything worth hearing, so they will say you are arrogant, call you too loud. They will come to your events, they will talk smack from that crowd. So you heed my warning, young man. You listen to me. You've got to be able to fight scrutiny, this thing like a bee, because you see people are so quick to antagonize, rarely to support. They are so quick to criticize as if every title given must be justified. But I was the greatest before I even knew I was. But just like I did, you have a whole lot to learn, because see, you are great, but clearly don't know how to be, so people see you as prophet, not person. But you are not a spectacle. You have no need to fight for your relevance, because true greatness should speak for itself. Man, it is always so tiring to put on your gloves and keep going, but you don't get no rest. Them rounds last eternity against that thick skin of yours. You got to be able to take as much as you can give. See, they always want to take a black boy down a shade. Always want a black boy not to celebrate. Like I can't be great, like you can't be great, like you can't call yourself a god and make a hymn at every soul beat. Like I beat on list and build a congregation where rhymes become scripture and the lyrical revival has folks praising Jesus. But if Jesus walks and Jesus speaks, ain't y'all both the same? Ain't Jesus a black man anyway? Ain't you a god, Kanye? See, your mouth was for shut, and you spoke through the wire. Now, don't that make you as revolutionary as all time? Don't that make you the greatest of all time? Ain't you an ultralight beam? Isn't this your God dream? So you can say you the greatest, because you and I both know to be champions. Sometimes our biggest fights, they happen outside the ring. They tried to stop me from fighting. Said that I wasn't acting like the people's champ, but to be champion is self-defined. So if you feel yourself divine, you pay the mothers no mind. You be unapologetically black. Put your soul in them lines, son. You know this the best. So rise and shine. Wake up, Mr. West.
I'll read a couple of poems by the Haitian poet Félix Maurice Olouat, followed by excerpts of a speech by Polish poet Wisława Szymborska. In the 20th century, Félix Maurice Olouat was one of the first and great advocates of the use of Haitian Creole in Haitian schools and government. This in the context in which French was the language of formal education, the language of power, the language of the 1% in Haiti. His decision to validate Creole, to write in Creole, to use it as a language of education and of literacy and of literature was a political one, a revolutionary one. It changed the landscape of Haiti and allowed people access to their government. I'm going to read a poem, the first of which I feel is germane to this situation today. And I'll read it in Creole and then give you my English translation of it. Moi-même ou même. Moi-même, ou même, lui-même, yo même. Comme dit moi, c'est lui-même. L'aime dit lui, c'est où? Yo, c'est moi, c'est lui, c'est ou même. Nous, c'est nous-mêmes, même. Nous toutes fines vieilles laides. Nous toutes coupables ou innocents à qui ont payé sous bran ou yon timoun malade. Me, you. Me, you. She, they. When I say me, it's him. When I say her, it's you. They are me, are she, are he, are you. We are ourselves, ourselves. We've all ended up old and tired, as guilty as innocent, with one country in our arms, like a sick child. He wrote this in the 1970s. And then I'll read you an excerpt of Jazz by Maurice Olouat. I'll read you the Creole first and then English. Dim, 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 dim. Men Jim no. Jim. Sou ba Jim, ma diw. Bam konesans m konen ou. Simba ou, wa bam. Pito pa Jim. Pito pa Jim. Jim ma diw. Sou vle Jim, Jim. Sou pa vle Jim, ba Jim. Ba Jim. Ba Jim. Ma diw. Tell me. Tell me. Tell me. Go ahead. Tell me. Tell me. If you don't tell me, I'll tell you. Give me the knowledge to know you with. If I give you something, you'll give me something. Maybe you shouldn't tell me. Maybe you shouldn't tell me. Tell me. I'll tell you. If you want to tell me, then tell me. If you don't want to tell me, don't tell me. Don't tell me. Don't tell me. But I'll tell you. Now the excerpts of the noble acceptance speech made by poet Wisława Szymborska in 1996, entitled The Poet and the World. All sorts of torturers, dictators, fanatics and demagogues struggling for power by way of a few loudly shouted slogans also enjoy their jobs. And they too perform their duties with inventive fervor. Well, yes, but they know. They know. And whatever they know is enough for them once and for all. They don't want to find out about anything else, since that might diminish their argument's force. And any knowledge that doesn't lead to new questions quickly dies out. It fails to maintain the temperature required for sustaining life. In the most extreme cases, cases well known from ancient and modern history, it even poses a lethal threat to society. This is why I value that little phrase, "I don't know," so highly. It's small, but it flies on mighty wings. It expands our lives to include the spaces within us as well as those outer expanses in which our tiny earth hangs suspended. If Isaac Newton had never said to himself, "I don't know," the apples in his little orchard might have dropped to the ground like hailstones, and at best, he would have stooped to pick them up and gobble them with gusto. Had my compatriot Marie Curie never said to herself, "I don't know," she probably would have wound up teaching chemistry at some private high school for young ladies from good families, and would have ended her days performing this otherwise perfectly respectable job. But she kept saying, "I don't know." And these words led her not just once, but twice to Stockholm, where restless, questing spirits are occasionally rewarded with the Nobel. Poets, if they're genuine, must also keep repeating, "I don't know." Each poem marks an effort to answer this statement. But as soon as the final period hits the page, the poet begins to hesitate, starts to realize that this particular answer was pure makeshift that's absolutely inadequate to boot. So the poets keep on trying. And sooner or later, the consecutive results of their self-dissatisfaction are clipped together with a giant paperclip by literary historians and called their oeuvre, their work. In daily speech, where we don't stop to consider every word, we use all phrases like the ordinary world, ordinary life, the ordinary course of events. But in the language of poetry, where every word is weighed, nothing is usual or normal. Not a single stone, and not a single cloud above it, not a single day, and not a single night after it. And above all, not a single existence, not anyone's existence in this world. It looks like poets will always have their work cut out for them. So if we, like most poets, as Szymborska suggests, are dissatisfied, we have our work to do. Thanks.
There are many voices that our incoming administration does not want to hear from. The new climate change denying cabinet and oil executive secretary of state certainly don't want to hear from climate scientists or journalists or people who are already suffering from climate instability. As I thought about the voices already struggling to be heard, from the poor in our coastal cities to the indigenous trying to protect their water and land, I thought about the youth. They can't vote yet, but they have the most to fear from leaders who seek to roll back progress towards a livable future. So I'm going to read the words of a 13-year-old boy from Louisiana who suffered from flooding this past August. He is one of 21 young people from the ages of 9 to 20 who are fighting for the legal right to a stable climate. They are bringing a lawsuit against the federal government for failing to address climate change adequately, thus violating their constitutional rights to life, liberty, and property. Motions to dismiss the case have been denied by a federal judge, and the youth are moving ahead, even calling on Rex Tillerson to be deposed. Here is the written testimony of Jaden Foyton, a 13-year-old citizen and resident of Rain, Louisiana. His voice is not literary, but it deserves to be heard. At 5 a.m. on August 13th, 2016, my siblings woke me up. I noticed there was water coming from under the door to my room. When I stepped out of my bed, I stepped in water that came up to my ankles. I stepped right in the middle of climate change. I was scared and I didn't know what to do. We called our mom and told her what was happening. Mom told us she was trying to get home, but she didn't know when she could get there. The roads were flooding. There were cars floating down highways. It took her all day to get home to us. Flood water continued to pour into our home. To try to keep us safe, we began using towels and blankets to cover the bottom of all the doors. Yet the flood waters kept pouring in through the doors, toilets, sinks, bathtubs, and even the roof. The flood waters also came in through the foundation under the carpet. Our toilets, sinks, and bathtubs began to overflow with awful-smelling sewage because our town sewer system also had flooded. My brother went to the police station to try to get help, but there was no one there. The hard rain and floods continued for 2 weeks. We had nowhere to go. There were no shelters. All the grocery stores were closed. We kept sleeping in our house that was full of sewage and flood water damage. A few days after the flood, my siblings and I began to get real sick. Everyone in my family had flu-like symptoms with fevers and sore throats, as well as stomach pain and diarrhea. We are not alone. Most people we know in the town of Rain are also sick. We think it is from the polluted water we've all been exposed to. 25% of our town went underwater. This flood has been called a 1,000-year event. Yet within the last 2 years, I have read about 8 500-year flood events. In less than 2 years, there have been 9 flood events that weren't even supposed to happen in my lifetime. My home is not supposed to be in a floodplain, but it just flooded. Climate change is real. While many people in our region drowned, we were fortunate in Rain not to lose any human life. Many pets drowned during the flood. We have had all types of creatures coming into our home. A snake, colonies of ants trying to escape the water, spiders. Horses of nearby neighbors had chemical burns up to their stomachs from touching the polluted flood water. We know of 5 spills from oil and gas infrastructure from flood damage, which is also polluting our waters. My family and I feel very vulnerable. These federal defendants know that more oil and gas drilling is bad. They know what the effect is. They are still trying to promote more oil and gas development that is hurting me, our generation, and future generations. Unless they are ordered to stop, these federal defendants will continue to cause destabilization of our climate, and more storms and floods will threaten my personal security, my life, my liberties, my property, and that of my family. I think these federal defendants should be required to go to a trial where they will have to explain in court why they plan to keep fossil fuel production and consumption and pollution increasing for decades when we are supposed to be eliminating fossil fuels by 2050. I am scared, but I will not back down. We will conquer climate change. Thank you.
I'm going to be brief. I'm Marta Rivera. I'm the coordinator of the Greater Boston Latino Network. I invite you to visit our website, greaterbostonlatinos.org, to learn more about our priority. Essentially, it's a collective of Latino executive directors who lead nonprofits that are Latino-focused, and we aim to increase Latino presence and voice at decision-making tables. So again, I encourage you to visit our website. So I'm going to be reading in Spanish and then in English, Los Dictadores, de Pablo Neruda. Ha quedado un olor entre los cañaverales, una mezcla de sangre y cuerpo, un penetrante pétalo nauseabundo. Entre los cocoteros, las tumbas están llenas de huesos demolidos, destertores callados. El delicado sátrapa conversa con copas, cuellos y cordones de oro. El pequeño palacio brilla como un reloj. Y las rápidas risas enguatadas atraviesan a veces los pasillos y se reúnen a las voces muertas y a las bocas azules frescamente enterradas. El llanto está escondido como una planta cuya semilla cae sin cesar sobre el suelo y hace crecer sin luz las grandes hojas ciegas. El odio se ha formado, escama a escama, golpe a golpe, en el agua terrible del pantano, con un hocico lleno de légamo y silencio. So it's titled The Dictators. An odor stayed on in the cane fields, carrion, blood, and a nausea of harrowing petals. Between coconut palms lay the graves in their stilled strangulation, their festering surfeit of bones. A finical satrap conversed with wine glasses, collars, and piping. In the palace, all flesh like a clock dial. The gloved laugh redoubled, a moment spanning the passageways, meeting the newly killed voices and the buried blue mouths. Out of sight, lament was perpetual and fell like the plant and its pollen, forcing a lightless increase in the blinded big leaves. And bludgeon by bludgeon on the terrible waters, scale over scale in the bog, the snout filled with silence and slime, and vendetta was born. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm Fred Marsant. You don't have to check the program. I am the last. One of the pleasures of being here for the entire afternoon is that I really wanted to change my reading several times over. So let me just tell you a little bit about that. That during the course of the afternoon, I was reminded multiple times by a very great line by a poet I knew well, William Stafford, where he talks about one of his poems. He says, look, take these words and keep them for life. And I felt everyone up here was saying that to all of us. Take these words, keep them for life, for heart, for guidance, for understanding, for knowing what it is we are actually looking at in this moment of our collective and national history. It does say, I'm going to read from Walt Whitman, but I have a paragraph from Democratic Vistas. And I recommend Democratic Vistas to everyone, but particularly this paragraph. It is, however, Walt Whitman. The paragraph is long. So I'm going to give you a very edited version of it, and then I'm going to read a very short poem of mine to end this part. In Democratic Vistas, it's written in 1870. It's after the Civil War, of course, and it's after the assassination of President Lincoln. And it is after the time when one could feel at ease, thinking all is one in the Union, and I mean that in every sense, the Union. That in Democratic Vistas, Whitman looks to the future and he says the following. I say we had best look our times and lands searchingly in the face, like a physician diagnosing some deep disease. Never was there, perhaps, more hollowness at heart than at present, and here in the United States. Genuine belief seems to have left us. The underlying principles of the states are not honestly believed in. For all this hectic glow and melodramatic screamings, nor is humanity itself believed in. We live in an atmosphere of hypocrisy throughout. The men believe not in the women, nor the women in the men. A scornful superciliousness rules in literature. The aim of all the literatures is to find something to make fun of. A lot of churches and sects with T. The most dismal phantasms I know, they usurp the name of religion. Conversation is a mass of badinage. I'm going to jump a bit. The depravity of the business classes of our country is not less than has been supposed, but infinitely greater. The next sentence really bothers me. The official services of America, national, state, and municipal, in all their branches and departments, except the judiciary, are saturated in corruption, bribery, falsehood, maladministration, and the judiciary is tainted. The great cities reek with respectable as much as non-respectable robbery and scoundrelism. And I'm going to jump to the very end, because I honestly think that what he does for the rest of this catalog is simply name the things that we're trying to name. And so you can trust me when I say that actually you've heard the rest of this paragraph, except for this last sentence. In vain do we march with unprecedented strides to empire so colossal, outvying the antique, beyond Alexander's, beyond the proudest sway of Rome. In vain we have annexed Texas, California, Alaska, and reached north for Canada and south for Cuba. It is as if we were somehow being endowed with a vast and more thoroughly appointed body, and then left with little or no soul. James Carroll began this set by reading that great poem of Daniel Berrigan. It was close to my heart too, even thought of it myself as a candidate. I'm going to end by reading a small answer to Daniel Berrigan's question about when would you say no to this war? The poem is called A Spell. To stay the hand, and my sense of that title is that we all sense the sort of the imminent murderous violence lurking in so many quadrants of our world, and specifically in our country right now. A spell to stay the hand. No. Not only word. Neither fetish nor totem. Not only thought, no, not even feeling, not a face or a shadow, not seed on wind, no, not stop signs on fire, no, not hands held up and up and up, up, no, not aim that is taken, down the barrel, no, not the pouch, no, not the clip, not the feet per seconds, the round will travel. No, not pin, no, not fires, no, not at them, there at the end of who we are. No, not you, no, not me, now, God, no one, not ever again, no. Thank you.
Thanks again to all of our readers. Thanks to everyone for coming out. I know we ran a little bit long, so I appreciate your patience through all the technical difficulties.
Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will.